Just when we think contemporary music has gone about as far as it can go, someone or something comes along and proves us all wrong. Parents' outrage generally goes hand in hand with teenage adulation. In the 50s, it was Elvis with his rock and roll guitar twanging and his hip-swiveling gyrations. Then, in the 60s, the advent of Beatlemania saw four lovable mop-tops from Liverpool take the world by storm. ABBA probably epitomised the 70s with computerised-style songs and space-age videos, which turned four talented Swedes into multi-millionaires. But now, it's 1984, and it looks as if a boy called George and his band are ready to take our musical imaginations one step further. Australia first experiences a culture shock at Sydney's International Airport, where thousands of fans gather several hours before the flight from Tokyo is due. This is the day they've been waiting for, a chance to catch a glimpse of the world's most enigmatic pop star. As the tension mounts, tempers fray, and police prepare to do battle to protect their boy. And now it's time for George, John, Roy and Mikey to face the fans. At last, in the relative security of the hotel car park, press photographers will finally catch up with their prey. George, welcome to New Zealand television.
Thank you.
Great to talk to you. The first time New Zealanders would have heard of Culture Club would have been the video Do You Really Want to Hurt Me, but it started a little bit earlier than that, didn't it?
Culture Club started about two records before then, but we put out three records in a row, really, you know, White Boy, then I'm Afraid of Me, then Do You Really Want to Hurt Me, because I think when you start a band, you know, if you lose the momentum, you know, of a new band, people forget about you very quickly, so we just kept pushing them out and hoping that one of them would be a hit, and Do You Really Want to Hurt Me was the one, yeah.
How did you find your band? How did you set about finding your band?
Well, I found Mikey because I was in Bow Wow Wow for a while, and I got dismissed for bad conduct, and, you know, I met Mikey, and we were, like, talking about forming a band for months and months and months, and it was never happening, and then I met John, who really instigated Culture Club. You know, he kind of forced it to happen. He was like Sergeant Major Moss. And that's really how the band started. And then we found Roy. So it was an easy period. It wasn't hard to find the musicians.
And the musicians that you have with you also have quite a large input in the band as well, don't they?
Yeah, I mean, you know, Culture Club is a band. I think a band is always going to be more successful than a solo artist because you're more at risk. You know, there's more people who want to infiltrate your situation. And with a band, you know, everybody's kind of protective towards each other, you know, like, no, you can't do that, you can't do this, you know. So if I ever wanted to go and sing with somebody else, I mean, I'd have a lot of problems. If I wanted to do, like, a solo project, I mean, I wouldn't be able to do that within Culture Club. So it's a pretty tight organisation.
Going back to your earlier days, did you always want to be an entertainer?
I don't think there was ever a time when I sat down and said, oh, you know, I want to do this. I think the problem was at school, everybody knew what they wanted to be, and I didn't. You know, everybody wanted to be a cashier or a pilot, you know, all these sort of things. I think everybody had it all worked out, and I was one of the people that didn't really have it worked out. I mean, I was watching this thing that Parkinson did on Culture Club, and there was a girl, she said, she had like a Mohican haircut, and she said, I don't want to do any work until I'm ready, which I think is basically the attitude of a lot of teenagers, you know. I mean, obviously, you can't do that always, but I was lucky because I drifted around for a while.
You didn't do enormously well at school, though, did you?
I did on my own level. Yeah. It depends what you call doing enormously well. I mean, I was good at art, I was good at English, I was very good at RE, religious education. All my sort of talk classes, like public relations classes, I was very good at. Mm. But the kind of school I went to, the attitude was if you can't kick a ball, then, you know, you can't swim and you can't draw. It was like, if you didn't do what they wanted you to do, they'd stop you from doing something else. Mm. And I think people have to be encouraged to do what they're best at. I mean, because somebody can't kick a ball, that doesn't mean they can't sing. You know, I mean, I can't play football, but I can sing, so I've got my own advantage points. And I think the school that I went to didn't really acknowledge that. You know, and they made a mistake. I mean, when I left, they told me that was it. You know, my future was like, so, you know.
You're out the door.
But I mean, you know, not everybody can be a pop star. Not everybody can achieve something from nothing. But I think, you know, the success of Culture Club, and especially from my point of view, I mean, I come from a working class background. I think it serves as an education to people. I think it makes people realise what is possible from nothing. And I think that's a good thing.
Were your family supportive of your chosen career?
I can't think, really. I mean, my father, when I was younger, was just sad, a good voice. But, I mean, if that's been supportive, I don't know. I mean, my father never really laboured anything for a long amount of time. He asked me if I'd go and work with him, and I said no. I mean, there was about 3 or 4 arguments about that. And then
what did he do?
He did building. But he never really forced the issue, you know. Mm. They never really, really went on about it. I mean, they wanted me to get a job, but I don't think they were really concerned with what sort of job it was. I think they just wanted me to eat, and once I'd left home, you know, they wanted me to to make sure that I had some kind of support for myself, you know.
Was it an easy time then, your sort of teenage years?
There haven't really been any times in my life that have been particularly difficult, you know. I mean, I didn't have a hard childhood, despite what people think. I didn't come from a particularly liberal background or a strict background. It was pretty well balanced, you know. There was enough discipline, you know, to stop me burning the house down. But basically, I wasn't tortured or anything like that. I mean, I had a very happy upbringing, and you know, most of the bad parts you were raised, you know. I mean, everybody has bad parts of their childhood, but I mean, none of them can be attributed to my parents, you know.
Because you're also involved in the Sadler's Wells Theatre as well, weren't you?
Well, I did when I left school. You know, I went and I used to obviously wear makeup then, and. Because I wore makeup, I got a job doing makeup at the Royal Shakespeare Company for about 2 months, which was really good. I got a lot of money for that. And it was a 2-month stint. I did lots of things. I mean, I was basically a jack of all trades, master of none, you know.
You were quite actively involved in the British punk scene. What made you go out and form a band whose musical style was so vastly different?
Because punk rock, I thought, was a very stupid thing, in the sense that, you know, there was a guy with, like, bright orange hair saying anarchy. And anarchy, logically, you know, viewed, is their freedom for the masses. And I'm afraid most people out there are sheep, and they jump on Johnny Rotten's head within seconds. And so I just thought the whole sort of attitude was very logical. I think that you have to take into account, if you're going to look bizarre, there are like 99% of the public won't agree with you and want an explanation. And if you go around spitting at people, I just didn't think it was a good situation to launch myself from. I thought that it was better to wait until I felt like, you know, having a career. Right. Until I could commit myself 100% to what I was doing. You know,
there were rumours going around that you're sort of a protege of Malcolm McLaren, but that's not true.
That's rubbish. Absolute rubbish. I mean, it's all very well and good for Malcolm to go around saying that he formed Culture Club, but he didn't at all. I mean, he's nothing to do with it. Absolutely not. Malcolm is a lying sod.
You created your own image then, really?
Well, there isn't an image. I mean, you know, has Joan Collins got an image? You know, I consider myself to be the Joan Collins of rock in a way. Because, I mean, I didn't sort of start dressing up because, you know, I was like Gary Glitter. You know, I mean, you never saw Gary Glitter walking down Bond Street in his tinfoil outfits, did you? But you see me walking around like this. I mean, I'm very real. I was chased by the sun, you know, to one of the beaches in Brisbane. And they couldn't understand why I was wearing makeup. I mean, people still haven't come to terms with the fact that I do it because I want to, and not because it's some gimmick. You know, I mean, there's things in the press saying, it's a well-devised gimmick to make me money, but it didn't make me money for 8 years. I knew people would react, but I also knew, given 5 minutes, I could convince them of my sanity. And I think I've done a pretty good job of that.